الحمد لله رب العالمين، الحمد لله ولي الصالحين، والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين، نبينا وإمامنا وحبيبنا وقرة عيننا وسيدنا محمد بن عبد الله، وعلى آله وصحبه ومن سار على دربه إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فالكلمة التي أحببت أن أقدمها بين يدي هذا اللقاء الذي أسأل الله تبارك وتعالى أن يجعله مباركا علينا جميعا.
The words that I wanted to say in the beginning of this gathering, which I ask Allah عز وجل to make it a blessed gathering for all of us.
هو حديث للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم حسن.
Is a hadith that is a Hassan hadith by the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
يقول فيه النبي الكريم صلوات ربي وسلامه عليه.
عليه الصلاة والسلام he says.
إنه ألقى روح القدس في روعي
surely,
أي في قلبي
surely the Holy Spirit he put into my heart my chest
أنه لن تموت نفس
that surely this is the revelation that was revealed surely no soul shall die
حتى تستكمل رزقها
up until it will completely and comprehensively attain its provision
فأجملوا في الطلب.
So be good in seeking your sustenance.
ولا شك أن جلكم ولا أقول كلكم.
There is no doubt that most of you, I don't say every one of you, but most of you.
جاء إلى هذه البلاد لطلب الرزق.
Most of you came to this country to seek sustenance and provision.
وكلنا نعيش في هذه الدنيا ونطلب الرزق.
All of us live in this life and we seek our sustenance, our daily living.
ولكن علينا أن نؤمن كذلك أن الرزق مكتوب.
But we also believe that our provision is already pre-written.
وأنه لن يموت واحد منا حتى يأخذ رزقه كله.
And that none of us shall die except after achieving and getting all of his provision.
وما كان من رزقي فليس يفوتني ولو كان في قاع البحار العوامق.
And that which Allah has made to be my provision, I will never miss out on it, even if it be in the deepest of the deepest seas.
ولو كان رزقي في فم الأسد لأخذته.
If my provision was in the mouth of the lion, I will still be able to take it.
ولو سعيت سعي الوحوش فلن تحصل إلا رزقك.
If you strive and labor hard, the striving of the fierce wild animals, then you will not be able to achieve except what Allah has already pre-written to be your provision.
وقد جاء في الصحيحين من حديث عبد الله بن مسعود.
It has come in the two Sahihs, Bukhari and Muslim, from the hadith of Abdullah bin Mas'ud.
أنه قال.
That he said.
حدثني الصادق المصدوق.
That the one who is truthful, the one who is told the truth, that is Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he narrated to me.
أنه أن أحدكم يجمع خلقه في بطن أمه 40 يوما.
That the creation of one of you, the humans, is gathered together within the belly, the womb of his mother, 40 days.
ثم يكون علقة مثل ذلك.
Then he will be a blood cloth, the likeness of that, the likeness of that period.
ثم يكون مضغة مثل ذلك.
Then it will be like something that is chewed up, a piece of lump that is like a bite, the likeness of that period of time.
ثم يرسل إليه الملك فينفخ فيه الروح.
Then the angel is sent to him and he blows into him or breathes into him the soul.
ويؤمر بكتب أجله.
And the angel is commanded to write down his lifespan.
ورزقه
and his provision and sustenance
وعمله
and his actions
وشقي أو سعيد خاتمته
whether he will be happy or sad his end how it is going to be
فإذا كان الأمر كذلك
so if the affair is as such
فلا نفكر كثيرا في الرزق
then let us not think too much about our sustenance our earning
ولا نهتم بذلك كثيرا
and let us not pay too much attention to that
فما كتبه الله لك سيأتيك
for whatever Allah has pre-written for you it will come to you
إن سعيت في الحلال ستأخذه
if you strive and labor in that which is halal means you will take your provision
وإن سعيت في الحرام ستأخذه.
And if you strive and labor hard in haram means still you will get your sustenance.
فلماذا نسعى في الحرام إذن؟
Why is it then that we strive and labor hard through haram means?
وقد ذكروا قصة طريفة في هذا الأمر ولكنها نافعة إن شاء الله.
They mentioned a story that is kind of funny in this regard, but then it is beneficial إن شاء الله.
ذكروا أن رجلا من أهل البادية.
They mentioned that one person from the Bedouin area countryside.
جاء إلى المدينة ليبيع ويشتري.
He came to المدينة to buy and sell.
وأهل البادية يبيعون الصوف ويبيعون اللبن ويبيعون الغنم.
The Bedouins, they sell wool, they sell meat, they sell sheep.
ويشترون احتياجهم من التمر والقمح وغير ذلك.
They buy what they need of dates, wheat, and other than that.
فدخل هذا إلى السوق واشترى حاجته وباع ثم اشترى حاجته ويريد أن يرجع إلى بلده.
This person, he went into the marketplace, he sold what he brought of the items, and he bought whatever he needed, is preparing to go back.
وحمل على البعير ما اشتراه.
He loaded on his camel. He loaded whatever stuff he bought.
وجعل جميع ما اشتراه في جهة واحدة على البعير.
And he made he put all of what the items he bought, the merchandise, he put it on one side of the camel.
وجعل في الجهة الثانية ترابا حتى يكون التوازن.
On the other side of the camel, he put dust there, sand, so that the camel will be balanced.
ثم أراد أن ينطلق إلى البادية.
Then he wanted to go to the Bedouin area.
فرآه أحدهم فقال له: So ما الذي تحمل البعير؟ لا يكاد البعير أن يمشي. كيف سيصل؟
He said, What are you loading up here on this camel? The camel is unable, is about not to be able to walk. So how is it that he is going to go?
فقال له هنا التمر والقمح والشعير وكذا وكذا.
So he said, on this side there is the dates, the wheat, the barley, and so on, so on, so on, so.
وفي هذه الجهة رمال.
And on this other side there is just sand.
قالوا هل تحتاج إلى الرمال في البرية؟
He said to him, do you really need the sand in the Bedouin area?
فقال لا هذا للتوازن.
He said, no, this is just for balancing it out so that the camel will be justly balanced and will not fall.
فقام هذا الرجل قال أعطيه دقيقة ثم جاء وفتح أكياس الرمال وأسقط الرمل.
He said, give me a minute. He came, this man, he opened up those tied up bags of sand and all of the sand went on the floor.
ثم ذهب إلى الجهة الثالثة فيها التمر ووزعها على الجهتين.
And he went to the merchandise that he bought, the dates and the wheat, and he distributed them on both sides of the camel.
ثم قال الآن يرتاح البعير وأنت تستطيع أيضا أن تركب عليه.
He said, now the camel will be comfortable and you yourself you can ride on it.
ففرح هذا الأعرابي وقال له ما شاء الله أنت ذكي جدا.
The Bedouin Arab, he got very happy and he said, ما شاء الله, you are so smart.
فقال له لست ذكيا الأمر سهل جدا لكن أنت لم تنتبه. قال لا أنت ذكي.
He said I'm that smart, it's just it's very easy, it's just you didn't you know take note of this. He said no you are very smart.
فقال أريد أن أسألك.
He said I want to ask you a question.
على هذا الذكاء الذي عندك ماذا عندك من المال.
He said I want to ask you about this cleverness that you have, what do you have of the money, the wealth.
قال لا أملك شيئا.
He said I don't own anything.
قال لا لا يمكن أنت ذكي.
No it's impossible. He said you're so smart.
قال أحيانا أنام دون عشاء.
He said sometimes I go to bed without dinner.
قال كل هذا الذكاء وتنام بدون عشاء.
He said all of this cleverness and you go to sleep without dinner.
قال نعم.
He said yes.
قال أنا عندي من الماشية والإبل. He said, إذا وقفت عند أوله لا تستطيع أن ترى آخره.
He said, I have of the sheep and the camels. If you stand at the beginning of the flock, you cannot see the end of it because of the so many sheep and also camels I have.
فقال له الرجل بارك الله لك فيما رزقك.
So the man told him, may Allah bless you in whatever you have.
فقال الأعرابي أنا ما قلت هذا حتى تقول لي بارك الله لك فيما رزقك.
The Bedouin Arab, he said, I did not tell you this so that you tell me, you will tell me, may Allah bless you in what you own.
لكن أردت أن أقول لك أرجع الرملة إلى مكانه.
But I wanted to tell you, have this sand go back to its place, those bags.
لو كان العقل ينفعك نفعك.
If intellect and intelligence benefits people, then it would have benefited you.
وأنا على ما أنا عليه والله ما شاء الله بارك لي في رزقي.
And I am going to be upon what I am upon, and ما شاء الله الله عز وجل blessed me in what He provided for me.
فدعني وذكائك.
So leave me alone and you know go with your cleverness.
فالقضية إذن أرزاق مكتوبة. So عند الله تبارك وتعالى.
The provisions are already recorded with Allah عز وجل.
ولذا قال المتنبي.
This is why المتنبي.
ذو العقل يشقى في النعيم بعقله.
He said the one who is intelligent and genius, he would be, you would find him in difficult life, although he has this intellect.
وَأَخُ الْجَهَالَةِ فِي الشَّقَاوَةِ يَنْعَمُ.
And the person of ignorance, he is actually enjoying his life, although he should be wretched and sad, but then he is enjoying his life.
فنطمئن إلى أرزاقنا وأن الله كتبها سبحانه وتعالى.
So we should be accepting and we should be comfortable with our provisions and that Allah عز وجل has already pre-recorded that for us.
ولا نسعى إلا بالحلال.
And we should not strive and labor to achieve our sustenance except through halal means.
وأسأل الله تبارك وتعالى أن يكفينا بحلاله عن حرامه.
And we ask Allah عز وجل to suffice us with his halal from his things that he made haram.
والآن نبدأ بال.
And now we can start with the questions. طيب, so the questions are so many, so I will try to inshallah يعني do our best with that. يقول كيف نوفق بين الآية الكريمة والحديث إن صح الآية وإذا سألك عبادي عني فإني قريب أجيب دعوة الداعي إذا دعان والحديث إن صح من شغله ذكري عن مسألتي أعطيته أفضل ما أعطي السائلين. The ayah, he says, how do we combine between the two, make them agree? The ayah, if my servants ask you about me, I am near, I respond the call of the callers, the caller when he calls upon me. The hadith, if it is authentic, then it says the one who whose my remembrance gets him busy from asking me, I will give him the best of what I give those who ask.
نعم. هذا الحديث لا يصح ولا يثبت.
This hadith is not authentic.
والآية فاصلة في هذا الموضوع.
And the ayah is decisive in this regard.
وقد ثبت عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عن رب العزة تبارك وتعالى.
It is established from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم from
أنه قال
the Lord of Might that he said, this hadith قدسي.
من لم يسأل الله يغضب عليه.
The one who does not, he said, the one who does not ask Allah, Allah is angry with him.
فالله تبارك يقول أدعوني يدعوننا رغبا ورهبا.
Allah says call upon me, Allah says they call upon me out of fear and hope.
فدعاء الله واجب.
So calling upon Allah is a must. دعاء is a must.
وهذا الذي هو ظاهر الآية.
And this is what this is the apparent meaning of the verse.
وكذا المشهور عن إبراهيم عليه الصلاة والسلام.
Likewise, what is being famous or widespread from Ibrahim عليه الصلاة والسلام.
أنه قال علمك بحالي يغني عن سؤالي.
That your knowledge of my condition suffices me from asking you.
أيضا هذا باطل لا يصح.
This is widespread that Ibrahim said that, but it is a false statement, is not authentic from him.
والإنسان يجب عليه أن يدعو الله تبارك.
And it is a must upon the person, the individual, to ask Allah عز وجل. يا شيخنا ما حكم البول قائما وكيف أجمع بين الحديثين, حديث أتى سباطة قوم فبال قائما وحديث عائشة أنها قالت من أخبرك أنه بال قائما فلا تصدقه. This the brother is asking about urinating while standing, and he mentions two ahadith. One of the ahadith is that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم came to a place belonging to a people, and they used to throw their garbage in there. So he urinated standing. The other hadith is from Aisha saying that the one who told you that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم urinated standing, do not believe him.
الأصل في هذه القضية,
the principle regarding this issue,
أن هذه في الأصل ترجع إلى الأعراف كانت,
that this goes back or is referred back to the customs of the people.
وكان العرب قبل الإسلام,
the Arabs before Islam,
لا يبولون إلا قياما,
they use not to urinate except standing.
ونقل الحافظ ابن حجر رحمه الله تعالى,
ابن حجر رحمه الله تعالى, he reported
أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قبل البعثة,
that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم before he was sent as a prophet,
رآه أحدهم يبول وهو جالس,
one person saw him urinating while sitting.
فقال انظروا إلى محمد يبول كما تبول النساء.
He said, look at Muhammad, he urinates like women urinate.
فيرون من الأنف أن يبول الرجل جالسا.
So they see it to be not good. They are too arrogant to urinate sitting.
أما بعد بعثة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم,
as for after the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was sent,
فأخبرت عائشة رضي الله عنها,
عائشة رضي الله عنها reported,
أنه من حدثكم أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بال قائما فلا تصدقوه,
that the one who narrated to you or tells you that Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم urinated standing, do not believe him.
ما كان يبول إلا جالسا.
He used not to urinate except sitting.
طبعا عائشة رضي الله عنها تحدث بما رأت.
عائشة رضي الله عنها, she is narrating what she saw.
وهي تراه في البيت.
And she sees him at home.
لكن حذيفة بن اليمان رضي الله عنه,
but حذيفة بن اليمان, may Allah be pleased with him,
رضي الله عنه عن أبيه, لأن أباه صحابي أيضا.
May Allah be pleased with him and his father, because his father is also a companion.
حدث أنه رأى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يبول قائما.
He narrated that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم he saw him urinating standing.
فقال أهل العلم,
so the people of knowledge said,
عائشة حدثت بما علمت.
عائشة she narrated what she knew.
وحذيفة حدث بما علم.
And حذيفة narrated what he knew.
فكلا الأمرين جائز.
So both affairs are allowable.
لكن عائشة حدثت عن غالب حال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
But عائشة she spoke about the majority of the condition of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
وحذيفة حدث أنه مرة واحدة رأى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
And حذيفة narrated here that he one time he saw the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم doing that.
فقال أهل العلم,
so the people of knowledge said,
الأصل أن البول يكون جالسا.
The principle, the rule is that you urinate while sitting.
وإن بال قائما فلا بأس.
And if one urinated standing, then there is no harm.
بشرط أن يأمن رشاشة البول لا يصيبه.
But with the condition that you are safe from the urine splashing back on your clothes. ما حكم شرب الماء قائما, وهل الشرب قائما فقط عند شرب ماء زمزم كما فعل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم؟ What is the ruling about drinking water while standing, and is it specific to just drinking the water of Zamzam that you should drink standing?
ثبت أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم,
it is established that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم,
رأى رجلا يشرب قائما,
he saw a man drinking while standing.
فقال له,
he said to him,
أيسرك أن يشرب معك الهر,
would you be happy to have the cat drinking with you?
قال لا.
He said no.
قال فقد شرب معك من هو شر من الهر.
Then surely Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم told him something that is worse than the cat has been drinking with
الشيطان.
You. Satan was drinking with you.
ومنها أخذ أهل العلم,
and from this the people of knowledge they took,
النهي عن الشرب قائما,
the forbiddance of drinking while standing.
ولكن ثبت في صحيح البخاري,
but it is established in the صحيح of البخاري,
عن علي رضي الله عنه,
from علي, may Allah be pleased with him,
أنه توضأ وكان جالسا,
that he made wudu and he was sitting.
فلما انتهى من الوضوء,
so when he finished making wudu,
قام وشرب الماء وهو قائم.
He stood up عليه الصلاة والسلام and he drank the water while standing. علي while standing.
إيه. فكان يتعمد لهذا.
So it's as if علي رضي الله عنه was deliberately doing that.
فقال بلغني أن أناسا يكرهون الشرب قياما.
He said it has reached me that some people they dislike drinking while standing.
وقد رأيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يشرب قائما.
And I have seen the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم drinking while standing.
ولذلك ذهب أكثر أهل العلم,
the majority of the people of knowledge, they are of the position
الشرب قائما جائز.
That drinking while standing is allowable.
وبعضهم ذهب إلى الكراهة.
And some of them, they are of the position that it is disliked.
وقليل جدا من ذهب إلى التحريم.
And very few who are of the position that it is prohibited to drink standing.
والأقرب والعلم عند الله تبارك وتعالى.
The closest of these positions, and Allah is all knowledgeable.
أنه جائز.
That it is allowable to drink while standing.
ولكن الشرب جالسا أفضل.
But to drink sitting, it is better. يسأل عن حكم الحركات الزائدة في الصلاة ويقول إنه كثير من الشباب والصبيان يتحركون كثيرا ويقولون في كلام سمعونه إذا تحرك المصلي أكثر من ثلاث حركات فلا تصح الصلاة. He says, what is the ruling about the extra movements that the people do while praying? He sees many youth and young children, they move a lot in the prayer, and he heard that it is said that if you moved, the praying person moved more than three movements, then his salah is null and void.
نعم هذا ذهب بعض أهل العلم وهو مذهب أبي حنيفة والشافعي.
Yes, some of the people of knowledge, like the position of Abu Hanifa and Ash-Shafi'i, they are of this position.
إلى أنه لا يجوز أن يتحرك أكثر من ثلاث حركات.
That it is not allowable to move in the prayers more than three movements.
وبعضهم ذهب إلى بطلان الصلاة.
And some of them, they are of the position that the salah is null and void.
قال لأنه ينافي الخشوع.
They said because it completely in opposition to خشوع, humility in the prayer.
ومذهب أحمد كذلك النهي عن كثرة الحركة.
And the madhab of Imam Ahmad also is that it is to the forbiddance of moving a lot in the prayer.
لكن لا يحددونه بثلاث.
But they do not restrict it to three movements.
ولكن يقولون ما كثر عرفا.
But they say what customarily it is known that it is a lot of movements.
بحيث الذي يراه لا يدري هل هو يصلي أو لا يصلي.
In a way that the person who is looking at him, he doesn't know if he's praying or not because he's moving so much.
وقد جاء في حديث.
It has come in a hadith.
لو سكن قلب هذا لسكنت جوارحه.
That if the heart of this person was tranquil, then his body parts will be tranquil and at peace.
لكنه حديث ضعيف لا يثبت.
But it is a weak narration that is not established from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
ومشهور أنه من كلام سعيد بن المسيب.
And it is what is well known or famous is that it is from the statements of سعيد بن المسيب.
وهو من التابعين.
And he is from the second generation of Muslims, تابعين.
أما الحركة في الصلاة.
As for the movement in the prayer.
فالصحيح والعلم عند الله تبارك وتعالى.
So what is correct and the knowledge is with Allah تبارك وتعالى.
أنها تنقسم إلى خمسة أقسام.
That it is categorized into three into five categories.
بحسب الأحكام الخمسة.
According to the five legal rulings.
حركة واجبة.
A movement that is a must.
حركة مستحبة.
A movement that is recommended.
حركة مباحة.
A movement that is allowable.
حركة مكروهة.
A movement that is disliked.
وحركة محرمة.
And a movement that is haram.
أما الحركة الواجبة.
As for the obligatory movement.
فلو كان الإنسان يصلي إلى سترة.
So if a person is praying towards a cover, something that is in front.
وأراد أحد أن يمر بينه وبين سترته.
And someone wanted to pass between him and his cover.
فيجب عليه أن يمنعه.
So it is a must upon him to prevent him from that.
لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
Because of the statement of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
لو يعلم أحدكم ما ينقص من صلاته.
If one of you knows how much his salah will be diminished.
لما ترك أحدا يمر بينه وبين الستر.
Then you wouldn't leave anyone passing between you and your cover.
فهذه حركة واجبة.
So this is a movement that is a must.
وكذا لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا كان أحدكم يصلي إلى سترة.
Likewise the statement of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم that if one of you is praying to a cover.
وأراد أحد أن يمر بين يديه.
And someone wanted to pass in front of him.
فليمنعه.
Let him prevent him.
فهذه حركة واجبة.
So this is a movement that is obligatory.
وهناك حركة مستحبة.
There is a movement that is recommended.
كقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
Because of the statement of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
من وصل صفا وصله الله.
The one who joins a line, connects a line, Allah connects with him.
فلو كنت تصلي في الصف.
So if you are praying in the line.
وصار فراغ في الصف الذي أمامك.
And there is a space, a blank space in the line that is in front of you.
فلك أن تتحرك حتى تسد هذا الفراغ.
So it is allowable for you to move on to fill up that gap.
أو كان فراغ عن يمينك أو عن يسارك.
Or if there is a gap to your right or to your left.
كذلك تتحرك لتسد هذا الفراغ.
Likewise, you move to fill in the blank space.
لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
Because of the statement of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
من وصل صفا وصله الله.
The one who connects a line, joins a line, Allah connects with him.
فهذه حركة مستحبة.
This is a movement that is recommended.
وهناك حركة مباحة.
There is a movement that is allowable.
وهي التي تكون لحاجة.
And that is that you do for a need.
وقد ثبت عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
It is established from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
كما في البخاري.
As in Bukhari.
أنه كان يصلي.
That he was praying.
أمامة بنت زينب حفيدته.
And he would be carrying عليه الصلاة والسلام أمامة the daughter of Zainab, his grand daughter.
فكان إذا أراد أن يركع وضعها في الأرض.
So he when he wants to make ركوع عليه الصلاة والسلام, he would place her on the floor.
فإذا أتم الركعة الأولى وأراد القيام من الركعة الثانية حملها معه مرة ثانية.
If he finishes the ركعة and he wants to get up for the second ركعة, he will carry her again with him.
وهذا أيضا فيها يعني سعة للنساء مع أطفالهن.
This actually gives room for يعني an allowance, a concession for the women with their kids. They can carry.
وكذا كان إنسان يصلي فجاء الذبابة أو نحلة على عينيه أو كذا.
If someone was praying and a fly came or a bee came on his eye or in his head.
فلا مانع أن يحك وجهه يحرك يده
للحاجة. There is nothing wrong if he moves his hand or he rubs that place because of a need.
فهذه حركة مباحة.
This is a movement that is allowable.
والنوع الرابع وهي الحركة المكروهة.
The fourth kind and that is the disliked movement.
وهي التي ليس لها سبب.
And that is done. That is the one done without a reason.
مجرد العبث.
Just playing around.
وهذه مكروهة.
And this is disliked.
وإذا كثرت.
And if it is done a lot.
فهنا تكون محرمة.
Here it becomes prohibited.
وتبطل بها الصلاة.
And the salah becomes invalid because of it.
ومن هنا قال بعض أهل العلم أنها إذا كان ثلاث حركات فأكثر.
And because of
لأنها
this,
صارت كثيرة.
Some of the scholars they said if they were three movements and more, this is now it became too much.
يقصدون هذه الحركة التي ليس لها داعي إلا العبث.
They mean that this type of a movement that there is nothing calling for it except just playing around.
وبعضهم جعلها معلقة بالعرف إذا كانت كثيرة عرفا بحيث الذي يراه لا يدري هل هو يصلي أو لا يصلي.
Some of them linked it, some of the scholars linked it to the custom in a way that if someone looked at this person and he would think that he is not praying according to what is customarily known because of the many movements, he would tell that this person actually is not praying.
وقد رأيت صديقا لي.
I have seen a friend of mine.
بعد أن انتهينا من الصلاة.
After we finished praying.
وكنت أنا في الصف المتقدم عليه.
And I was in the line in front of him.
فلما أردت أن أخرج من المسجد.
When I wanted to leave the masjid.
وجدته from the masjid, يعبث بأصابعه وينظر.
I found him playing with his fingers, intertwining them, and looking at me.
فجئت ليسلم عليه.
So I came to shake hands with him.
فنزل يده وصار يحرك يده.
So he put his hands down and he started moving his finger for the tashahhud.
فهذا كنت لا أدري هل هو يصلي أو لا.
So I didn't know if he was praying or not.
وغلب أظني أنه لا يصلي.
And what I most likely thought that he was not praying.
فهذه هي الحركة التي هي عبث.
So this is the movement that is just someone is in vain, يعني playing around. طيب جزاك الله خيرا يا شيخ. في أسئلة عن طلب العلم يعني جمعتها. Some of the يعني ما نصيحتك للطالبات لطالبات العلم في هذا البلد. An advice to the female students or seekers of knowledge in this country. They get busy with so many things. يشغلنا بأشياء كثيرة ولا يستطعنا الرحلة إلى بلاد المسلمين لطلب العلم. So they cannot seek knowledge. What is your advice for them to raise their, you know, ambition, their aspiration? ما نصيحتك لهن لرفع الهمة في العلم؟
نعم. النساء الأصل أنهن شقائق الرجال.
The principle regarding the women is that they are the twins of the men. You know, they are just their sisters.
وقول الله تبارك وتعالى يرفع الله الذين آمنوا منكم والذين أوتوا العلم درجات يشمل الرجال والنساء.
The statement of Allah Ta'ala that Allah truly raises those who believe amongst you and those who have been granted knowledge, Allah raises them in so many levels and degrees. This is inclusive of men and women.
وأيضا قول الله تبارك وتعالى إنما يخشى الله من عباده العلماء يشمل الرجال والنساء.
Likewise, the statement of Allah Ta'ala that there only fears Allah from His servants, the scholars. This inclusive of men and women.
وكذا قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من سلك طريقا يلتمس فيه علما سهل الله له به طريقا إلى الجنة.
Likewise, the statement of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم that the one who treads a path seeking knowledge, then Allah will makes an easy way for him to paradise. Also includes both.
ولا شك أن الرحلة في طلب العلم مهمة جدا.
And there is no doubt that taking a journey, traveling to seek knowledge is very important.
ولكن ليست هي كل شيء.
But it is not all there is.
فإمام دار الهجرة.
The Imam of Dar al-Hijra, the place where Rasulullah
sallallahu alayhi wa sallam migrated, which Rasulullah
sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned about him that it is about time that the people will travel to him to seek knowledge under him.
الإمام مالك بن أنس,
and that is Imam Malik ibn Anas.
لم يرحل في طلب العلم.
He never traveled.
ومع هذا شد الناس الرحالة إليه في طلب العلم.
Yet the people actually they were the ones who traveled to him to seek
فالنساء
knowledge.
يمكنهن طلب العلم دون الرحلة.
So the women they can seek knowledge without traveling.
خاصة الآن مع تيسر السبل ولله الحمد والمنة.
Especially nowadays when those many means have been facilitated for seeking knowledge.
فتستطيع أن تطلب العلم عن طريق الأشرطة والكتب والإنترنت وغير ذلك.
Seek knowledge through the audio tapes, internet, and other than that.
وأحياناً تحضر درساً على الهواء مباشر وتشارك.
And sometimes she can attend a lecture live, and she can also participate in that lecture.
فمن كانت جادة منهن في طلب العلم.
The one who is serious amongst them in seeking knowledge.
فلتتذكر قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
Then let her remember the statement of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
من سلك طريقا يلتمس فيه علما.
Whoever takes a path or threads a path to
سهل الله له به طريقا.
A way to seeking knowledge, then Allah عز وجل will make an easy way for him to paradise.
وهذا طريق في طلب العلم.
And this is a way to seek knowledge.
ولتحرص على الحفظ قدر ما تستطيع.
Let her be keen and diligent to memorize as much as she can.
والتكرار.
And to repeat.
ولعل الفراغ الذي تجده في بيتها.
And maybe the free time that she has in her home.
وانشغال الرجل في طلب الرزق.
And the fact that the man is busy earning his sustenance.
فهذه فرصة عظيمة لها لتقدم على طلب العلم.
This is a great opportunity for her to embark upon seeking knowledge.
مع الحرص على أن تتلقى العلم الصحيح من العلماء الثقات.
Alongside with her being keen and diligent to seek the knowledge, to receive the knowledge from the scholars who are trustworthy. After learning the whole Quran, what can I do to keep it without forgetting it? I tried many methods. What do you recommend? السؤال بعد حفظ القرآن كله ماذا يمكن أن نفعل حتى لا ننسى القرآن؟ حاولت طرق متعددة لكن بماذا تنصحني؟
الصلاة.
I recommend for you the prayer.
قيام الليل.
Night prayer.
الضحى.
And الضحى.
أن يراجع حفظه وإن القرآن يتفلت.
Review your memorization because the Quran can easily slip away.
فيجعل الإنسان له وردا.
So you have a specific portion.
إما في الضحى.
Either ضحى time.
أو في الليل.
Or at night time.
لمراجعة المحفوظ.
To review what you memorized.
نعم.
Which books of fiqh should a student of knowledge begin with when studying fiqh? أي كتب الفقه طالب العلم المبتدئ عليه أن يبدأ بها في تعلم الفقه؟
والله أنا أنصح في كتب الفقه أن يبدأ بكتب الفقه المذهبي.
I advise you regarding seeking knowledge of fiqh is to start with the fiqh books that are upon a certain مذهب.
أي مذهب كان؟
Any of the مذهبs.
حنفي، مالكي، شافعي، حنبلي، ما يضر.
Any of these مذاهب.
لأنها تضبط المسائل وتنتظم فيها القواعد.
Because those books, they sort of regulated the issues, and also they have some sort of rules and principles in there.
والأصل أن يتلقاه من عالم أو طالب علم.
And the principle is that you receive this type of knowledge and understanding from a scholar or a student of knowledge.
بحيث يفك له الرموز ويشرح له الأمور.
In a way that this scholar or student of knowledge, he will explain to you the matters and he will undo the symbols in there. He will explain them.
ثم بعد ذلك ينتقل إلى أحاديث الأحكام.
Then after that you move on to the أحاديث pertaining to the rulings.
خاصة كتاب عمدة الأحكام مع شروحه.
Especially the book عمدة الأحكام alongside with its explanations.
أو بلوغ المرام وشروحه كسبل السلام مثلا.
Or بلوغ المرام and the explanations of it like سبل السلام for instance. This is the same question. A sister wants to seek knowledge. She doesn't know where to begin. I think the Sheikh answered that. هذه الأسئلة تسأل عن الشفاعة. A brother is asking about, or a sister asking about intercession. What can we do in order to achieve the level? And I'm paraphrasing those questions. What can we do to achieve the level where we can intercede for our loved ones if they go to the hellfire wal-iyadu billah? How can we achieve that status that Allah will love us in a way that we will be able to intercede on behalf of the others, the loved ones who went to the fire? السؤال يعني في أكثر من سؤال أنا جمعتها في سؤال واحد. كيف نستطيع أن يحبنا الله بحيث يرزقنا منزلة الشفاعة، أننا نشفع في أحبابنا الذين ممكن أرسلوا إلى النار.
نعم. طبعا الشفاعة
intercession
جعلها الله تبارك وتعالى للرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم.
الله سبحانه وتعالى made it for the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. Granted it to the messenger.
ثلاث شفاعات خاصة.
And he has three special intercessions that are specific to him عليه الصلاة والسلام.
وهي الشفاعة الكبرى.
And that is the great intercession.
وهو المقام المحمود.
And that is the praiseworthy station.
وهو نفسه الوسيلة.
And that is the same that is called الوسيلة, the means.
عندما نقول بعد الأذان وبعثه مقاما محمودا الذي وعدته.
And when we say after Adhan, O Allah, send him to get that praiseworthy station that you promised him.
وهي الشفاعة عند الله ليقضي بين الخلق يوم القيامة.
And that is the intercession with Allah عز وجل, so that he will judge between the people on the day of judgment.
ثم الشفاعة الثانية وهي الشفاعة لدخول الجنة.
The second شفاعة or intercession is the intercession to enter paradise.
وهو أول من يطرق باب الجنة.
And he is the first one عليه الصلاة والسلام that will knock at the door of paradise.
صلى الله عليه وسلم.
عليه الصلاة والسلام.
والشفاعة الثالثة لعمه أبي طالب خاصة.
The third intercession is special and specific only to his paternal uncle أبو طالب.
لأن عمه أبا طالب نصره وأيده ودافع عنه.
Because his paternal uncle أبو طالب, he supported him and he defended him.
فقال له العباس رضي الله عنه هل نفعت عمك بشيء؟
العباس said to him his uncle did you defend your uncle أبو طالب with anything؟
فقال نعم.
He said yes.
كان في ضحضاح من النار.
Did you benefit him in any way? He said yes, I did. He was in a fire that is يعني up to his ankles, and Allah Azza wa Jal gave me intercession regarding him.
فخفف عنه العذاب.
So Allah reduced the punishment from him.
فهو لم يخرج من النار لكنه خفف عنه العذاب.
So he did not come out from the fire, but Allah عز وجل reduced the fire, the punishment.
ثم بعد ذلك الشفاعات التي تكون للأنبياء.
Then after that the intercessions that Allah granted the prophets.
ثم الشفاعات للملائكة.
Then the intercession that is given to the angels.
ثم الشفاعات للشهداء.
Then the intercession of the martyrs.
ثم شفاعات لعامة المؤمنين.
Then intercessions that Allah grants to the believers in general.
والله سبحانه وتعالى يقول في كتابه العزيز.
Allah عز وجل says in his mighty book.
والذين آمنوا واتبعتهم ذريتهم بإيمان ألحقنا بهم ذريتهم.
Those who believed and their descendants followed them in faith, we made them in the same ranking as their descendants. We had their descendants be in the same rank as theirs.
فإذا كان الناس في الجنة.
So if the people are in paradise,
وصلى الله يجعلنا وإياكم جميعا من أهلها.
We ask Allah عز وجل to make us all from its people.
فإنه لا ينزل أحد من درجته.
Then no one in paradise will be lowered from the high position that he got.
ولكن يرفع الله إليه ذريته.
But rather Allah عز وجل raises up and elevates up to his ranking his descendants, his children.
وكذلك يرفع إليه أمه وأباه.
Likewise he will raise up to him, to his high position, his father and his mother.
فكل مؤمن صالح.
Every righteous believer then,
وله أقارب,
who has relatives,
أقل درجة منه في الجنة,
who are lower than him in paradise,
فإن الله يتبع بعضهم بعضا في العلو.
Allah عز وجل will make them follow them in their rank or be with them in their higher rank.
هذا عدا أن الله يشفع المؤمنين.
This is aside from the fact that Allah عز وجل grants the believers intercession
في أهليهم ممن كتب عليه دخول النار
regarding their family members who are destined to enter the fire
بشرط أن يكون مؤمنا.
This is with the condition that those that you intercede for are believers.
لكنه قصر بوقوعه في الكبائر.
He is a believer but he has fallen short by falling into committing major sins.
نعم.
ما الحكمة من تعرض بعض الأطفال للاعتداءات والأمراض مع أنهم لا ذنوب لهم؟ What is the wisdom behind children being exposed to transgressions, to sicknesses, although they have no sins?
أولاً لابد أن نعلم أن الله جل وعلا لا يفعل الشر.
First of all, we should know that Allah عز وجل does not do evil.
وكل فعله لحكمة.
All of his actions are for a wisdom.
فقد تراه أنت شرا وهو ليس بشر عند الله تبارك وتعالى.
You might view it to be evil, but it is not evil with Allah عز وجل.
وصحيح أن الأطفال لا يعاقبون.
It is true that the children are not punished in this worldly life.
ولكن لأن الله تبارك وتعالى أحيانا.
But it is because that sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala
يريد أن يعجل لهم بالجنة.
He wants to rush them to enter paradise.
وذلك أنه من المعلوم.
That is because it is well known.
بإجماع أهل العلم.
With the unanimous agreement of the people of knowledge.
كما نقل ذلك ابن عبد البر.
As Ibn Abd al-Barr has reported that.
وإن خالف البعض في ذلك.
Even though some disagreed with him in this.
أن أطفال المسلمين الذين يموتون قبل البلوغ من أهل الجنة.
That the children, the Muslim children who die before reaching the age of puberty, then they are from the people of paradise.
والذي عليه جماهير أهل العلم.
What the position that the vast majority, the overwhelming majority of the people of knowledge are upon?
أن أطفال المشركين الذين لم يبلغ الحلم أيضا وماتوا.
That the children of the polytheists, the mushrikeen, who did not reach the age of puberty and they died before that.
كذلك من أهل الجنة.
They are likewise from the people of paradise.
لأن الأصل أن كل مولود يولد على الفطرة.
Because the principle is that. Every newborn is born according to the state of the natural disposition of Islam.
كما في الصحيحين.
As in the two Sahihs, Bukhari and Muslim.
وكذلك جاء في بعض الأحاديث.
Likewise, there has come in some أحاديث.
أن كل مولود يولد على الإسلام.
That every newborn is born upon al-Islam.
فلذلك.
This is why.
لا تظنن أن هذا تعذيب من الله تبارك وتعالى لهم.
Do not ever think that this is a torture that Allah عز وجل is torturing those children.
وإنما قد يكون هذا تنبيها لغيرهم.
Rather, this might actually be to bring the attention and to alert those who are other than them.
حتى يعرف نعمة الصحة التي رزقها أولاده.
So that he will recognize the favor of health that Allah عز وجل has granted his children.
فيعتني بهؤلاء الأولاد.
So he would look after those kids.
وهم أيضا لا يضرهم ذلك بل هم مكرمون عند الله تبارك وتعالى.
And they also they are not harmed by that those kids they are not harmed by that لا يضرهم ذلك عند الله هؤلاء
الذين بالعكس ينعمون
في rather they are going to be this does not harm them rather they are going to be enjoying in paradise.
ولذلك صار الأنبياء أكثر الناس بلاء.
This is why the prophets they are the ones who are tried the most.
مع أنهم أكرم خلق الله عليه.
Although they are the most honored of the creation in the sight of Allah.
وقال ابن مسعود للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وهو في مرض الموت.
ابن مسعود رضي الله عنه said to رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم while he was in his sickness of death.
إنك توعك وعكا شديدا.
He said you are going through so much pain.
فقال له النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم
So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to him
إني أوعك رجلين منكم
I receive, I go through pain like two men amongst you.
فقال له ابن مسعود
So ابن مسعود said to him
أذلك لأن لك الأجر مرتين
Is this because you receive the reward twice?
قال نعم
He said yes.
فهؤلاء أكرم الخلق على الله
These are the most honored creation by Allah.
ويبتلوا
Yet they are being tried.
بل جاء في الحديث.
Rather, there has come in the hadith.
أن الناس يوم القيامة.
That the people on the day of judgment.
يتمنون أن لو عاشوا في البلاء في هذه الدنيا.
They wish that they will live through a lot of trials in this worldly life.
لما يرون من إكرام الله تبارك وتعالى الذين ابتلوا في هذه الدنيا.
Because of what they see of the honor and the generosity that Allah engulfs those people who were in pain and trials in this worldly life.
ولعل هناك حكما أخرى لا نعلمها والعلم عند الله جل وعلا.
And maybe there are other wisdoms that we do not know and Allah is the most knowledgeable سبحانه وتعالى. رجل صلى قيام الليل وكانت عنده الساعة غلط نظر إلى الفجر وذهب وقته ولم يصلي الوتر ماذا يفعل لصلاة الوتر he said that a man he was praying night prayer and the clock that he had was giving the wrong time so after a while he got to know that the time of fajr is already gone he did not pray يعني the time of fajr is already in يعني he did not pray witr what does he do with صلاة الوتر
نعم ذهب علي رضي الله عنه وعائشة رضي الله عنها إلى أنه يجوز أن يؤدي الفجر طالما أنه لم تقم الصلاة إلى ما حتى لو بعد الأذان
عائشة and علي رضي الله عنهم they are of the position أنه هو يسأل
يمكنه أن يصلي الوتر
يصلي الوتر okay that they are of the position that one can pray the witr prayer even if the time of fajr is in he does that before the صلاة الفجر
وأكثر أهل العلم
and the majority of the people of knowledge
على أنه يصلي الوتر بعد صلاة الفجر ويكون قضاء
and that he would pray witr after fajr and it will be a make up يعني he is making up witr قضاء
وبعض أهل العلم ذهب إلى أنه يصليها بعد ارتفاع الشمس يعني في وقت صلاة الضحى
and some of the people of knowledge they said that he should pray it after the sun rises in the time of ضحى
والذين قالوا هذا بعضهم قال يصليها وترا وبعضهم قال يصليها شفعا
And those who are of this position, some of them they said he would pray it as a witr prayer as he missed it. And some of them they said rather he prays it not as odd numbered but even numbered.
والأصل الله أعلم أنه يصليها وترا.
And the principle and the origin in this regard, Allah knows best, the Sheikh says, is that he would pray it as witr.
وهذا في من لم يتعمد.
This is regarding the one who did not deliberately miss witr.
والله أعلم.
Allah knows best. رجل يكون مسافر في الطائرة ولا يعلم وقت الصلوات والطائرة تطير 14 ساعة ولا يعلم اتجاه القبلة. A man he would be traveling, he doesn't know the timing of the prayers, and the airplane is going on and 14 hours flies for 14 hours. He doesn't know the direction of the قبلة. What does he do?
يعني الحمد لله الآن التقنيات الحديثة سهلت كثير من
هذه the new technology have made many of these things easy.
يستطيع أن ينظر من مسار الطائرة.
He can look at the direction of the airplane.
أين توجد جزيرة العرب؟ ويصلي إليها.
Where is the Arabian Peninsula? He can tell by the route or the route that the airplane is going. He can tell where the Arabian Peninsula is, and he directs himself towards that.
أو أين آسيا.
Or even he can tell where Asia is, and he directs himself towards.
يعني الأمر سهل جدا في قضية معرفة القبلة.
So the issue is very easy regarding knowing the direction of the قبلة.
هذا عدا أجهزة الهاتف التي تحدد لك أيضا موضع القبلة.
Aside from these phones that we have now, that they have the ability to distinguish or to direct you towards the قبلة.
فقضية القبلة أتصور أن أمرها سهل. ويستطيع أن يسأل المضيف أو كذا.
The issue of the قبلة, I think it's easy, and he can also ask those attendants there in the airplane.
أما معرفة أوقات الصلوات.
As for knowing the timings of the prayers.
فمن رحمة الله تبارك وتعالى.
It is from the mercy of Allah تبارك وتعالى.
أن المسافر له أن يجمع بين الصلوات.
That the traveler he can combine between the prayers.
فيستطيع أن يعرف أن الآن هو وقت الظهر والعصر أو وقت المغرب والعشاء.
So he can tell now it is time ظهر and عصر or time of مغرب and عشاء.
وكذا يستطيع أن يعرف وقت الفجر.
And likewise he can tell the timing of فجر.
وإن ضغط عليه الأمور فعلى البلد الذي تحته.
And if he matters were kind of difficult for him, then he will use the timing of the country where he is, that's under the airplane, where he is above there.
واتقوا الله ما استطعتم.
And fear Allah as much as you are able.
وإن ظهر أن تقديره كان خطأ.
And if it appeared to him that his estimations were wrong.
وصلى بعض الصلوات بعد خروج وقتها.
And he prayed some of the prayers after the time is gone or elapsed.
فهو معذور.
Then he is excused.
وإن كان صلى بعض الصلوات قبل دخول وقتها.
And if he prayed some of the prayers before their timing was in.
فيعيدها إذا وصل إلى الأرض.
Then he repeats those prayers when he arrives on the earth, on the ground. هذا نفس السؤال تقريبا وسألناه مع بعض. ما حكم الشرع في من أجبر على طلاق زوجته من قبل الأهل؟ هل يقع؟ وقد أفسد حياة الزوج والأولاد. What is the legal ruling regarding the one who was forced to divorce his wife from the family due to the family? The family made him do that. Would this طلاق divorce count? And this divorce has corrupted the life of the husband and the children.
كيف أجبر؟ هل بالتهديد بالضرب؟
How was he forced? Is it by threatening? Is it by beating?
أو مجرد الأمر.
Or is it just by them ordering him to do so? أظن بالأمر.
على كل حال إذا كانوا هددوه بقتل أو ضرب.
Threatened him with killing or beating.
فهذا لا يقع طلاقه.
This طلاق, this divorce, this type of divorce doesn't count.
ولو تلفظ به.
Even if he pronounced the words of divorce.
وهذا ما يسميه أهل العلم بطلاق المكره.
This is what the people of knowledge call the divorce of the one who is forced.
أما إذا فقط قالوا له طلق.
But if they just told him divorce her.
فليس له أن يطيعهم.
Then it is not for him to obey them.
خاصة إذا كان زوجته صالحة وهو مرتاح معها.
Especially if his wife was righteous and he is comfortable living with her.
فلا يطيعهم فيها.
Then he does not obey them in that. Can we wash clothes that has najasa, impurity, stool, urine, blood, so on, so in the washer? Is that considered طاهر, I think, pure? يقول غسلنا الملابس في الغسالات وهذه الملابس فيها نجاسة مثل البول ويعني الدم كذا, هل بعد غسلها تصير طاهرة؟
نعم هذا هو الأصل.
Yes, this is the principle or the origin.
الأصل في النجاسة إزالة عينها.
The principle regarding najasa impurity is to remove the item of the impurity itself. The physical entity of this impurity is removed.
وإزالة أثرها.
And to remove also the traces of the najasa.
فإذا بقي لها أثر بعد الغسل.
If some traces were left after washing.
كاللون الذي قد لا يذهب.
Like the color may not go away.
فاتقوا الله ما استطعتم.
Fear Allah then as much as you are able to.
وليس فيه شيء إن شاء الله.
There is nothing wrong with that, inshallah. Is meditation considered a form of accepted ibadah instead of nafil ibadah, as our Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم meditated in the cave of Hira? هنا استعمل كلمة meditation يعني التأمل والتفكر. هل هذه نوع من العبادة بدل من التطوع بالعبادات النوافل؟ يجلس ويتأمل يشبه به ما حصل في غار حراء للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
هذه من أعظم العبادات.
This is from the greatest of types of worship. يعني لو توضحون بس الفرق بينها وبين اليوغا وما إلى ذلك. إيه. هكذا meditation هذه أخشى منها يعني.
هذه من أعظم العبادات التي يغفل عنها الناس.
This is the reflection and thinking and pondering is from the greatest forms of worship that the people are heedless from.
كما قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه العزيز.
As Allah تبارك وتعالى said in His mighty book.
إن في خلق السماوات والأرض.
Surely in the creation of the heavens and the earth.
واختلاف الليل والنهار.
And the alternation of the day and night.
لآيات لأولي الألباب.
Surely there are signs for the people of understanding.
الذين يذكرون الله قياما وقعودا.
Those who remember Allah while standing and sitting.
وعلى جنوبهم.
And on their sides.
ويتفكرون في خلق السماوات والأرض.
And they reflect and think about the creation of the heavens and the earth.
فعبادة التفكر.
So the worship of reflecting.
عبادة عظيمة.
Is a great act of worship.
ينبغي أن يعطيها الإنسان شيئا من وقته.
The human should give it, dedicate some of his time for it.
وقد نص أهل العلم.
And the people of knowledge explicitly said.
على أن هذا هو الظاهر من عبادة النبي في حراء.
That this is what is apparent from the ibadah, the worship that Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم used to do in the cave of Hira.
بل إن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كما هو معلوم.
Rather the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, as it is well known,
جلس في مكة 13 سنة.
He stayed in Mecca 13 years.
ولم تشرع الصلاة ولا الصيام ولا الحج ولا الزكاة.
صيام حج زكاة was not even legislated then.
إلا ما ذكر عن الصلاة أنها شرعت قبل الهجرة بسنتين أو سنة وشهرين.
Except for صلاة, what is mentioned about it, it was legislated before هجرة. 2 years or so before Hijrah.
أما الحج والصوم والزكاة فكلها كانت في المدينة.
حج صوم زكاة, all of that was legislated in Medina.
فكانت كثير من عبادات النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في مكة وأصحابه هي نوع من التأمل والتفكر.
So many of the worship that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and the companions used to do then in Mecca, most of it was this reflecting, pondering and thinking.
وهذا خلاف ما عليه هؤلاء الذين يقولون في اليوغا وغيرها.
And this goes against what those who are doing this type of meditation, yoga and the likes of that.
الجانب البدني في العبادة.
Which they actually neglecting the body part that the ibadah, the act of worship, which involves the body in it.
غير الدعوة التي يدعونها من اتصال بالسماء والتأثير.
They abandon that and they claim that they are somewhat connected to the heavens and you know get affected and the likes of that.
فالقصد أن العبادة الروحية في الإسلام ثابتة.
What is the objective here is that this type of spiritual type of worship in Islam is a valid type of عبادة.
ولكن كل شيء له قدره.
But everything has its due measure. هذا السؤال يسأل عن لبس الطاقية أو غطاء الرأس وحكمه في الإسلام, وهل هو سنة, هل هو يتبع العادة أم هو يخالف, يعني هل ينبغي الإنسان يلبس هذا في عباداته في صلاته في خروجه. This is a long question, but it's about basically wearing a head cover, a hat or the likes of that. Is it something legislated in Islam? Is it sunnah or is it recommended? Is it something that is pertaining to the customs of the people, the likes of that? So just
نعم,
generally.
هذا مشهور عند الأحناف.
This is famous. This issue is famous in the Hanafi madhab.
وذلك أنهم يستندوا على حديث ولكنه لا يصح.
That they use a hadith for that, but that hadith is not authentic.
أنه من صلى صلاة في قلوب سوى خير من 70 صلاة بغيرها.
That the one who prays a prayer wearing a head cover, a kulunsuwa hat, is better than 70 salah, better than 70 prayers that you pray without having the head cover.
ولكنه حديث لا يثبت عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
But it is not a hadith that is not established from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
وبالتالي الأمر داخل تحت قول الله تبارك وتعالى.
Therefore, the matter is under the statement of Allah تعالى.
يا بني آدم خذوا زينتكم عند كل مسجد.
O children of Adam, take your adornment at every prayer place.
فإذا
place
كان غطاء الرأس من الزينة في بلده.
So if the head cover is part of the adornment in the country where you live in.
فيصلي بذلك.
So he should pray wearing a head cover.
وإذا كان ليس من الزينة.
And if it is not considered from the adornment.
فإنه يكشف رأسه.
Then you can uncover your head.
في هذا واسع إن شاء الله.
And the affair in this regard is like there is concession. It's easy, you know. It's vast. It's not like just one thing. Here the عرف. طيب هذا سؤال عن يعني استعمال الكلب. Can people have a dog? Can a Muslim use a blind Muslim have a guide dog to assist him in daily living? هل يستطيع المسلم الأعمى أن يستعمل الكلب يعني الذي يقوده في حركته؟ وما علاقة هذا الموضوع بالعرف؟ يقول إنه هنا العرف في كندا أنهم يستعملون الكلاب كثيرا، هل ممكن إدخال قضية العرف في هذا؟
اختلف أهل العلم في هذا.
The people of knowledge differed in this regard.
والذي جاء في الحديث عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
And what has come in the hadith from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
أنه نهى عن اقتناء الكلاب.
That he commanded or forbid command not to or forbid buying or having dogs.
إلا كلب ماشية أو حرث أو صيد.
For sheep. Or for farming, for farming,
أو الصيد.
Or hunting, a dog for hunting.
هذا الذي أذن فيه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
This is what the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم allowed.
وقاس عليه أهل العلم كلب الحراسة.
And the people of knowledge they used by analogy the dog, the guard, that is the guard dog.
وذلك للحاجة إليه.
That is because there is need for it.
فلو قدر أن الأعمى لا يجد من يعني يقوده.
So if we estimate or think that the blind person does not find a guide to guide him.
ولا يجد بديلا عن الكلب.
And he does not find a replacement for a dog.
فلعل هذا يدخل في الحاجة.
Then this may be included in this need.
ولكن لا أتصور يعني أن هذا يصل إلى هذه المرحلة.
But I do not think that this may reach this level.
ولذلك كل حالة يفتى لها على قدرها.
So therefore every case is given a fatwa, a religious verdict according to its the condition of that specific case.
وقد تدخل في باب يعني الضرورات تبيح المحظورات.
And it may be entered or included under the principle that necessities make prohibited things allowable.
وهذه القاعدة مقيدة بقاعدة أخرى.
And this principle is restricted with another fiqh principle.
تقول الضرورات تقدر بقدرها.
Which that principle says that the ضرورات, the necessities, they are only given their due measurement or regard, meaning you do not expand on them, you use them as much as you need them.
والله أعلم.
And Allah knows best. Another question related to this. يسأل هذا الأخ يقول ابنه سأله يعني إذا كان لعاب الكلب نجسا فكيف نستطيع أن نستعمل كلب الصيد؟ قال لم أعرف ماذا أجيب ابني. This brother, he says his son or his child asked him if the saliva of the dog is impure, how is it then we are allowable to use hunting dogs?
قال أهل العلم
the people of knowledge said
إن هذا مما يعفى عنه
that this is something that is exempt, that is excused.
لعموم البلوى به.
Because it is a problem that is so vast and so widely happening. So it is excused.
ومثل هذا يدخل في صيد الطير.
And this
ونسر وغيره.
Also the same is the same by the same token, the same thing, the same rule is regarding the hunting through the birds.
وهذه ليست من باب نجاستها ولكن من باب أنها تأكل من الصيد ولا بد.
This is not from those birds. This is not from the aspect that they are impure. But then those hunting birds, they actually eat from what they hunt. From that aspect.
والأصل أن الصيد بالحيوانات بشرط ألا تأكل.
And the principle is that hunting using animals is allowable, but then with the condition that those animals do not eat from the prey.
لقول الله تبارك وتعالى أحل لكم يسألونك ماذا أحل لهم؟
Because
ماذا
of the statement of Allah تعالى, they ask you what is it that is allowable for them.
قل أحل لكم الطيبات.
Say to them, pure things are allowable for you.
وما علمتم من
من الجوارح.
وما علمتم من الجوارح مكلبين تعلمونهن مما علمكم الله. فكلوا مما أمسكنا عليكم.
And what you train of these, the animals that you use to hunt with, Allah says about them, so eat from those animals that they hunt or that they catch for you.
فقالوا إذا أكل منه صاد لنفسه ولم يصل لصاحبه.
So the scholar said that if the animal eats from the animal that it caught, then it is hunting it for its own self, not for the trainer that sent it,
or the owner that sent it. من صيد الطيور حتى تأكل منها.
But then
الجوارح لازم تأكل الجوارح.
But this يعني معفيون عن هذا.
أيوه.
But the scholar said that the birds, if you use birds to hunt, then they are excused, even if they eat from those prey, because they have to eat from those.
وعلى كل حال هو بعد أن يصيده الكلب. لابد أن يغسل.
Anyway, after the dog catches or hunts this animal, after it is caught, that animal has to be washed.
حتى الصيد نفسه الدم الذي يخرج منه نجس.
Even the prey itself, after it is caught, the hunted animal, the blood that comes out of it is najis, so it has to be washed.
كاللعاب.
Like the saliva, it has to be washed. I think it is time for Salah. Huh? أكيد. طيب. كيف يشعر العبد أنه من أولياء الله وكيف نوفق بين الحديث القدسي كنت سمعه وبصره وبين الابتلاءات التي يصاب بها العبد. How is it? How could the servant of Allah feel that he is from the allies of Allah? And how do we combine between the Qudsi hadith, I will be his hearing, his eyesight, and so on and so forth, and how do we combine this, how do we understand this, alongside with the trials, the problems that the allies of Allah go through?
لنتفق على مسألة.
Let us agree on one issue now.
هل الأنبياء من أولياء الله أو لا؟
Are the prophets from the allies of Allah or no?
لا شك أن الأنبياء هم سادات الأولياء.
There is no doubt that the prophets are the leaders and masters of the allies of Allah.
وهم أشد الناس بلاء.
And they are the ones who are tried the most severely tried.
فالعكس هو الصحيح.
So the opposite is what is true actually here.
أن الابتلاء غالبا يدل على المحبة.
That going through trials, being tried, mostly it indicates love, the love of Allah.
وما يزال الابتلاء بالعبد حتى يلقى الله وليس عليه خطيئة.
And the trials and continue to happen to the servant up until he meets Allah having no sin on him at all.
وكان بعض السلف يحزن إذا لم يبتلى.
Some of the pious predecessors, they used to become sad if they are not tried.
ويقول في نفسه لو كان الله يحبني لابتلاني.
He says within himself, if Allah loves me, then he would have tried me.
وصحيح أن الإنسان لا يتمنى البلاء.
And it is true that the person, the human, should not wish for trials.
إنه لا يدري ينجح أو لا ينجح.
Because he doesn't know whether he will be succeeding or not.
ولكن إن أصابه البلاء صبر.
But if he was hit with a trial, then he should be patient.
فإذا لم تصب بالبلاء فاحمد الله.
If you are not going through trials, then calamities, then praise Allah.
وإن أصبت بالبلاء فاصبر وتجلد.
And if you are hit with a trial, then be patient and be very strong.
وتذكر قول الله تبارك وتعالى.
And remember the statement of Allah تبارك وتعالى.
الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا.
The one who created life and death, or death and life, to try you, who amongst you is best in doing good deeds.
وهناك أحاديث وآيات كثيرة في هذا الموضوع.
And there are أحاديث and verses that are a lot in this regard.
أذكر منها قول الله جل وعلا.
I mentioned from them the statement of Allah تعالى.
أم حسبتم أن تدخلوا الجنة؟
Do you think that you will enter paradise?
ولما يأتكم مثل الذين خلو من قبلكم.
And the example of those who were before you will not happen the same to you.
مستهم البأساء والضراء وزلزلوا.
They were touched with difficulty and hardship, and they were shaken up.
حتى يقول النبي والذين آمنوا متى نصر الله.
Up until the prophet and those who believe, they say, when is the victory of Allah coming?
ألا إن نصر الله قريب.
Surely the victory of Allah or the support of Allah is very near. شيخنا الفضل, ما نصيحتكم لمن يقول نأخذ بالقرآن ولا نرضى بالسنة النبوية لعدم تثبتنا من صحتها ولأن القرآن هو الدين وهو كلام الله؟ What is your advice to the one who says we only take the Quran, we do not accept the prophetic Sunnah because we are not sure of its authenticity and because the Quran is the religion and it is the speech of Allah؟
طيب, وكيف عرفت أن القرآن هو ثابت؟
How do you know then that the Quran is truly established, that it is from Allah؟
القرآن نحن ما سمعناه من الله جل وعلا.
The Quran we did not hear it from Allah.
ولا سمعناه من الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم.
We did not hear it from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
والذين نقلوا لنا القرآن.
And those who reported the Quran to us.
هم الذين نقلوا لنا السنة.
They are the ones who reported the Sunnah to us.
إما أن نقبل قولهم.
Either we accept their statement.
أو نرفض قولهم.
Or we reject their statement.
فإن كانوا ثقات.
If they are trustworthy.
قبل منهم القرآن والسنة.
The Quran and Sunnah will be accepted.
وإن كانوا غير ثقات.
And if they are not trustworthy.
رفض منهم القرآن والسنة.
Then we reject from them the Quran and the Sunnah.
نقلة القرآن هم نقلة السنة.
The reporters of the Quran, they are the same as the reporters of the Sunnah.
والسنة لها علاقة بالقرآن كما قال أهل العلم من أربعة أوجه.
Has a relationship to the Quran or linked to the Quran from four aspects, as the people of knowledge said.
تكون السنة مؤكدة للقرآن.
The Sunnah may be emphasizing the Quran, confirming it.
وتكون مبينة للقرآن.
And it may be clarifying the Quran.
وتكون السنة مضيفة.
And the Sunnah may also add rulings to the Quran.
واختلف أهل العلم هل تكون السنة ناسخة للقرآن.
And the people of knowledge, they differed whether the Sunnah may be abrogating the Quran or not. May abrogate the Quran or not.
أما مؤكدة القرآن كقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بني الإسلام على خمس.
As confirming what is in the Quran, then like the statement of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم that Islam was built upon five.
شهادة لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله.
Testimony of faith, محمد لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله.
وإقام الصلاة.
Establishing the prayers.
وإيتاء الزكاة.
Giving zakat.
وصوم رمضان.
Fasting Ramadan.
وحج البيت.
And pilgrimage to the house.
وكلها مذكورة في القرآن.
All of these are mentioned in the Quran.
فمجيئها بالسنة للتأكيد.
So they have come in the Sunnah to emphasize them and to confirm them.
وتأتي السنة مبينة.
And the Sunnah comes to clarify what's in the Quran.
وهذا في أربعة أوجه.
And this has aspects.
إما أن تكون
whether it is explanatory to the Quran.
كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إن القوة الرمي.
As Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, surely the power is shooting.
الله تبارك وتعالى وأعدوا لهم استطعتم من قوة.
The statement of Allah. Whatever you are able of power or strength.
وتأتي السنة مقيدة. للقرآن.
The Sunnah comes restricting the Quran.
كما في قول الله تبارك وتعالى والسارق والسارقة فاقطعوا أيديهما.
As in the statement of Allah تعالى, cut off or chop off their hands for the thieves.
فجاءت سنة مقيدة بأنه الكف من اليد اليمنى.
So the Sunnah came restricting this ruling to mean that it is the hand of the right hand, the palm of the right hand. That is what is cut off.
وتأتي مخصصة لعموم القرآن.
And the Sunnah comes and it specifies the generality of the Quran.
كقول الله تبارك وتعالى.
Like the statement of Allah تبارك وتعالى.
يوصيكم الله في أولادكم للذكر مثل حظ الأنثيين.
Allah counsels you regarding your children that the male will get twice as much as the female.
وهذه تشمل جميع البشر.
And this is inclusive of for all humans.
ثم جاءت السنة.
Then the Sunnah came.
بقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
With the statement of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم.
إن معاشر الأنبياء لا نورث.
We, the prophets, we do not get.
فخصصت الأنبياء.
So it made this special and specific ruling for the prophets. They were accepted from the generality of the statement of the Quran.
وتكون مبينة.
And the Sunnah also may be clarifying the Quran.
كما قال الله تبارك وتعالى.
As Allah تبارك وتعالى said.
وأقيموا الصلاة.
Establish the prayers.
وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وصلوا كما رأيتموني أصلي.
The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, "Pray as you have seen me praying."
وقال الله ولله على الناس حج البيت.
And Allah عز وجل said, "And it is a duty upon the people to perform pilgrimage to Allah."
وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خذوا عني مناسككم.
And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, "Take from me your rites of Hajj."
فهذا كله من تبيين السنة للقرآن الكريم.
So all of that is the Sunnah actually clarifying the Quran.
وتأتي السنة مضيفة للقرآن الكريم.
And the Sunnah comes to add to the rulings in the Quran.
فالله جل وعلا قال.
Allah عز وجل said.
قل لا أجد فيما أوحي إلي محرما على طاعم يطعمه.
Say I do not find in that which was revealed to me anything prohibited for an eater who will eat.
إلا أن يكون ميتة أو دم مسفوحا.
Being a dead animal or blood that is shed.
أو لحم خنزير فإنه رجس.
Or the flesh of swine for it is impure.
أو فسقا أهل لغير الله به.
Or that the animal it was done, it was slaughtered as an act of wickedness that the name of other than Allah was called upon it when it was slaughtered.
فجاءت السنة فأضافت.
So the Sunnah came and it added.
أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم نهى عن كل ذي مخلب من الطير وكل ذي ناب من السبع.
That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم forbade eating every animal that has claws, bird that has claws, and every fierce animal that has fangs.
وجاء كذلك في كتاب الله تبارك وتعالى.
And also,
المحرمات من النساء.
It has come in the mention in the book of Allah Ta'ala regarding the prohibited women to get married to.
فقال الله جل وعلا حرمت عليكم أمهاتكم.
Allah Azza wa Jalla said it is prohibited for you your mothers.
وبناتكم.
Your daughters.
وأخواتكم.
Your sisters.
وعماتكم.
Your paternal aunts.
وخالاتكم.
Your maternal aunts.
وبنات الأخ.
And the daughters of your brothers.
وبنات الأخت.
The daughters of your sisters.
وأمهات النساء وأمهاتكم اللاتي أرضعنكم.
And your mothers that breastfed you.
وأخواتكم من الرضاعة.
And your sisters due to breastfeeding.
وأمهات نسائكم اللاتي دخلتم بهن.
And
وأمهات نسائكم.
And the mothers of your women.
وربائبكم اللاتي في حجوركم من نسائكم اللاتي دخلتم بهن.
And the women, the females that you are raising within your household from the women that you من نسائكم اللاتي دخلتم بهن, from the women that you have consummated marriage with them.
فإن لم تكونوا دخلتم بهن فلا جناح عليكم.
So if you did not if you didn't consummate the marriage with them, then there is no harm for you to get married to them.
وحلائل أبنائكم الذين من أصلابكم.
And the wives of your children who are directly your direct descendants.
وإن تجمعوا بين الأختين إلا ما قد سلف.
And that you combine between sisters, two sisters, except what has already happened in the past.
ثم قال والمحصنات من النساء إلا ما ملكت أيمانكم.
Then Allah عز وجل said and also the women who are already married. المحصنات من النساء. The women who are married, they are also prohibited for you to get married to.
فذكر 14 نوعا من النساء محرمة.
So Allah عز وجل mentioned 14 types of women that are prohibited to get married to.
فجاءت السنة.
So the Sunnah came.
وأضافت.
And added.
أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم نهى أن يجمع بين البنت وعمتها والبنت وخالتها.
That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم prohibited marrying the woman and her maternal paternal aunt and the woman and her maternal aunt.
كما في البخاري ومسلم.
As in Bukhari and Muslim.
فأضافت السنة حكما جديدا.
So the Sunnah added a new ruling.
وكذلك النسخ هذه فيها خلاف بين أهل العلم.
Likewise,
هل السنة تنسخ القرآن أو لا تنسخ؟
The issue of abrogation, there is a difference between the people of knowledge whether the Sunnah may abrogate, يعني cancel a ruling that is in the Quran or not.
فمن قال نأخذ بالقرآن ولا نأخذ بالسنة؟ So لا شك أنه سيضيع نفسه.
The one who says we take only the Quran, we don't apply or take the Sunnah, there is no doubt that he is putting himself to waste.
فمن أين له أن يعرف أن صلاة العصر أربع ركعات وأنها تؤدى بهذه الطريقة؟
How could he know that صلاة العصر is four units and that it is prayed in such and such a way?
وكيف يعرف الأذان؟
And how does he know the call to prayer?
وكيف يعرف مقادير الزكاة؟
And how does he know the amounts of zakat?
وكيف يعرف المحرمات في الصيام؟ المبطلات للصيام؟
Does he know the things that are prohibited in fasting and things that will invalidate the fast?
باختصار سيخرج عن الإسلام.
In a nutshell, he will be going outside of the fold of Islam. What is the best way for sons to honor their mothers or husbands to honor their wives in Islam? سؤال ما هي أفضل طريقة للأولاد لكي يكرموا ويبروا أمهاتهم؟ وللأزواج أفضل طريقة أنهم يكرموا زوجاتهم.
هذا أكيد سؤال من النساء.
This must be a question from women. يعني ممكن نضيف العكس إذا حبيت.
طبعا الأب له حق أيضا.
We can add the opposite to that. He said they have rights too.
على كل حال.
Anyway.
لا شك أن الأم لها حق أكثر من الأب.
There is no doubt that the mother has a right more than the father.
ولما سئل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم
when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was asked
من أحق الناس بحسن صحابتي قال أمك
who has the most right to my good companion my good company or companionship he was told by the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم your mother
قال ثم من قال أمك
he said then who he said your mother
قال ثم من قال أمك
then he said who then after that he said your mother
قال ثم من قال
said,
أمك
then who he said your father
فعزاؤنا لكم أيها الرجال
We offer you condolence, O men.
ولكن هذا دين الله.
But this is the religion of Allah.
نعم. فالقصد أن لا شك أن الأم لها منزلة عظيمة جدا.
The objective is that the woman has a great status.
ويكفيك أن تعلم أن رجلا سأل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
It is enough for you to know that a man asked the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم
عن طريق الجنة.
About the way to paradise.
فقال ألك أم؟
He said to him, "Do you have a mother?"
فقال نعم.
He said yes.
قال إلزم قدميها فثمة الجنة.
He said, "Stick to her feet, for there is paradise. That is where paradise is."
فحق الأم عظيم عند الله تبارك وتعالى.
So the right of the مother is great in the sight of Allah.
وهذا لا ينفي أن الأب أيضا له حق.
This does not negate the fact that also the father has a right.
وحق عظيم أيضا.
And a great right also.
ولكن ليس كدرجة الأم.
But it is not like the level or the degree or the level that the woman, the mother has.
ولذلك قال ابن عمر رضي الله تبارك وتعالى عنهما لرجل سأله.
This is why ابن عمر رضي الله تعالى عنهما said to a man who asked him.
وكان قد حمل أمه على ظهره وحج بها.
That man he actually carried his mother on his shoulders and he performed Hajj with her like that.
فقال لابن عمر هل وفيتها حقها؟
He said to Ibn Umar, "Did I fulfill her right?"
فقال ولا طلق من طلقاتها.
He said, "No, not even one cry of the pains of labor that she cried, not even one of those cries."
فإذا عرف الإنسان حق الأم,
so if the human knows the right of the mother,
لزم برها.
He would stick to being dutiful and kind to her.
وأما الزوج,
as for the husband.
فللزوجة حق عليه ولكن حقه عليها أكثر.
The wife has a right upon you, but then the right of the husband is even more.
فإذا طالبت بحقها من الزوج فلتعطيه أيضا حقه.
So if she requests her right from the husband, then let her give him his right too.
وهنيئا لكم أيها الرجال.
And I congratulate you, men, for that.
قد عوضكم الله تبارك
وتعالى. For Allah Azza wa Jal gave you some compensation.
نعم.
Compensated you. يعني نتوقف ولا نمشي للفجر ولا كيف؟
لا لا.
الساعة 11. Yeah, we stop here
inshallah.
Yes, so that those who want to leave, they can leave. Jazakumullah khairan ya Sheikh. أحسن الله إليكم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك. أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت.
الله يجزاكم خير يبارك فيكم وينفع بكم.
بارك الله فيكم. كرمكم الله يا شيخ. ما شاء الله صارت سريعة بعدين.